Hello everyone, this is Andreas Galanis and I will talk about the complexity of approximating averages on bounded degree graphs. This is joint work with Daniel Stefankovic and Eric Vigoda. So it is a classical result that finding maximum size independent sets is an NP-hard problem, and it remains NP-hard even for approximation algorithms. So in this talk, we'll focus instead on the average size of independent sets. So given a graph G, we'll look at the set of all independent sets of the graph G, and it will be interested in computing their average, that is the aggregate of their sizes normalized by their number. So this problem is connected to sampling, counting, and inference tasks, in particular to the problem of whether we can compute statistics of combinatorial structures. Another perspective, which we are going to adopt for this talk, is whether we can compute averages in Gibbs distributions. So what's a Gibbs distribution? The prototypical example here is the Ising model, which is a two-spin model. The model has two parameters, beta and lambda. Beta is an edge activity and lambda is a vertex activity, known also as the external field of the model. So configurations of the model are all 0-1 spin assignments to the vertices of a graph G. And the weight of a configuration sigma, of a spin assignment sigma, is lambda raised to the number of vertices with spin 1 under sigma, times beta raised to the number of monochromatic edges under sigma. That is edges whose endpoints under sigma have the same spin. The normalizing factor of this distribution is known as the partition function and is given by the aggregate weight over all spin assignments. The model is called ferromagnetic when beta is greater or equal than 1 and antiferromagnetic otherwise. In particular, when beta is less than 1, configurations with few monochromatic edges are favored. So independent sets can be cast into that framework, and they have been studied in the so-called hardcore model with external field lambda. So configurations of the model are all independent sets of the graph G. The weight of an independent set is given by lambda raised to the size of the independent set. So in the case lambda equals 1, every independent set has the same weight in the Gibbs distribution. Now you can view the hardcore model as a two-spin system by assigning spin 1 to vertices in the independent set and spin 0 otherwise. And the partition function is the aggregate weight of all spin configurations. Okay, so we'll be interested in computing averages of Gibbs distributions, and we'll focus on the magnetization, which is the average number of vertices that get spin 1 under a random configuration sigma. So we sample a configuration sigma according to the Gibbs distribution and we average the number of vertices that get spin 1. So in particular for the Ising model with lambda equals 1, we have perfect symmetry between the spin 0 and 1. So by linearity of expectation, we see that the magnetization in that case is given by the number of vertices divided by 2. In the case of the hardcore model with lambda equals 1, we obtain that the magnetization is equals the size of the average independent set. Another view of the magnetization is that it equals the derivative of the log partition function with respect to lambda. So in terms of computational complexity, it is known that the exact computation of magnetization is a number P hard problem, even on bounded degree graphs. So we'll instead focus on approximating the magnetization. And the problem we will focus on is understanding for which parameters beta and lambda we can approximate it. And here we'll be interested in relative error algorithms, and the holy grail is whether we have an FP Russian or an FP task. And it is known, a general result in this direction is that an FP Russian for the partition function, an approximation algorithm for the partition function, implies a sampler, an approximate sampler for the Gibbs distribution, which in turn implies an FP RAS for the magnetization. Unfortunately, it doesn't work the other way around. So, and an example is the antiferromagnetic Ising model for lambda equals 1. Magnetization is very easy. It's trivial, as we saw in the previous slide, but it is NP hard to approximate the partition function. And this we'll review in a moment. So, for the ferromagnetic case, though, we have an FP RAS for all beta greater equal than 1, and therefore an FP RAS for the magnetization as well. And in the antiferromagnetic case, we have both hardness and easiness. So we have both algorithmic results and hardness result depending on the values of the parameters. And there is a separation between the two regimes that is captured by the so-called uniqueness phase transition. So I will review how this looks for the hardcore model, but this applies for general two spin models, anti-ferromagnetic ones. So for the hardcore model, we will look at a graph G with maximum degree delta, constant maximum degree. And we will look at the approximability of the problem as the activity lambda changes, right? As the external field lambda changes. And below that critical value lambda critical, there is an FP task for the partition function for all graph G with maximum degree delta. Whereas for lambda bigger than the threshold in the so-called non-uniqueness regime, it's NP hard to approximate the partition function on delta regular graphs, even actually within an exponential factor. So there is a strong separation between the two regimes captured by this critical threshold. And the similar picture holds for the anti-ferromagnetic easing model. So in the non-uniqueness, you have NP hardness and the easiness otherwise. And this picture is far from complete. So in the sense that what's the best algorithms that we can achieve here in the easing zone? And there have been several new approaches. But I will not go into that, but instead go back to the magnetization problem. And in particular, yeah, what do we obtain? Well, this algorithmic results imply that there is an FP task for magnetization in uniqueness, but they don't imply anything for non-uniqueness. The natural conjecture there would be that it's hard, right? Just as it is hard to approximate the partition function, but one needs to be careful. So, the case of the anti-ferromagnetic easing model for lambda equals one implies that, well, we have that magnetization is trivial to compute, but the partition function is hard to approximate. And in particular, that precludes any general reduction from approximating averages to approximate counting. Moreover, it turns out that previous hardness techniques do not actually apply. So in short, what our work does is prove NP hardness for approximating the magnetization in non-uniqueness. So our result applies to general anti-ferromagnetic two-spin systems, models, and it gives constant factor in approximability for dense set of values, and almost constant, 1 plus minus 1/log n, in approximability factor otherwise. So just to give these results concretely for in the case of the hardcore model, we'll look at graphs of maximum degree delta, and again, we will look at this threshold, uniqueness threshold, lambda critical that we saw earlier. So our first result is the unweighted case. So there we prove that there's a constant C, says that for all delta greater equal than 6, it's NP hard to approximate the average size of an independent set from graph G of maximum degree delta within a constant factor. And this complements the previous algorithmic result. So it's known that for delta less or equal than 5, there is an algorithm to do that. Now, going to the general hardcore model, the weighted one, we prove that for every delta greater equal than 3, for every lambda bigger than the uniqueness threshold, you get an approximability of the magnetization with activity lambda within a factor of 1 plus minus k over log n. And we prove actually we can bootstrap that in approximability factor to a constant factor for a dense set of values in the non-uniqueness regime. So get this set S of algebraic numbers, which is dense in that interval, so that it's NP hard to approximate magnetization within a factor of 1 plus minus kappa. Okay, so similar results hold for the anti-ferromagnetic easing model, obviously when lambda not equal to 1, because otherwise we have a trivial algorithm. And actually to general anti-ferromagnetic two-spin systems that are in the non-uniqueness regime. What I will do next is describe the new techniques that are needed to obtain these theorems. And the main idea, as I'll explain later, is to construct pairs of gadgets that have the same occupancy ratio but different derivatives. Okay, so to explain what this means, let's look where first this uniqueness threshold comes from. And it comes from the delta regular tree. The so-called uniqueness phase transition in statistical physics. So we look at the delta regulatory of height h, and we'll look at the occupancy ratio of the root. Right? So we'll look at the, we'll focus on independent sets from now on. And we'll look at the relative weight of independent sets where the root belongs to the independent set over the set, the weight of all independent sets. Okay, and what I want to understand is what's the occupancy ratio as h grows. So if you can write a regression for that, what you can see is that basically if you plot this pH, you can see an oscillating behavior between even and odd h. So that's this oscillating behavior that you see here. And this comes actually because for even h, the root doesn't belong to the largest independent set, whereas for odd h, it does belong to the largest independent set. So you see this oscillating behavior, but when you're in the uniqueness regime, this effect dies out. This discrepancy between even odd and odd levels dies out, vanishes in the limit h goes to infinity. But above the uniqueness threshold, in non-uniqueness, this behavior persists. So how can you get out of that hardness? Well, it turns out that that's very tricky. And the key idea is to use a gadget G, a random bipartite graph, delta regular bipartite graph. Well, it's not quite delta regular. It has a few degree delta minus one vertices, yellow. So a small portion of them is going to have degree delta minus one. And the key point here is that this random delta regular graph, the local neighborhood of vertices resembles trees, right? So these are high girth graphs and they represent, they're very similar to delta regular trees, the neighborhoods locally. That what this means is you can expect that the same behavior that we saw earlier, this difference between even and odd, shows up between the plus and minus side of the bipartite gadget. In particular, if you look at the independent set, you can and define as the phase, as its phase, the side with more vertices. So plus if sigma has more vertices in on the plus side and minus otherwise. What you can show is that a typical independent set from the Gibbs distribution from that graph is going to be unbalanced. So you have a linear fraction of vertices, more vertices on one side than the other. And this bimodality is actually, its phase appears with probability approximately equal to a half. So basically this gives you a binary behavior of the gadget that allows you to encode binary CSP. And analyzing these gadgets was a difficult task and there were several papers trying to do that. And it's done, fortunately. And how can you use these gadgets in a reduction? So that was done by Sly. And his reduction is to use a hardcore oracle, an algorithm for approximating the partition function to solve the max cut problem. And the idea, let's say that you have this graph H that is input to max cut, the idea is to use the bipartite gadget and replace every vertex of H using the gadget. Okay, and that connections between between gadgets that correspond to neighboring vertices in H. Okay, and these connections, you can afford them because you have this degree delta minus one vertices where you can attach the edges. The main idea here is that a max cut assignment, you can view it as a phase assignment in the hardcore model. So you look at an independent set in this 8G graph and each gadget will get a plus or minus assignment depending on the configuration on the gadget corresponding to that vertex. So the phases give you a partition of the vertices of the graph into two parts. And the key point is because the interaction is repulsive, right? Two vertices are not allowed to be in the independent set. This shows up in the hardcore distribution in the sense by neighboring gadgets preferring to have opposite phases. So that's a key point. Right? And what this allows you is to obtain a connection with max cut. So there are plenty of calculations that computations that one has to do. But the rough idea is that the logarithm of the partition function of this final graph over the bipartite gadget gives you the value of max cut. So you need to pump things up, obviously. So you need to add more connections between the yellow vertices and make the gadgets relatively big. But other than that, that's basically what happens. Okay, so that looks very promising. So let's try to apply that for magnetization. What goes wrong? And the idea is that the magnetization, you can use linearity of expectation. So you have the gray part and the yellow part, the contribution from gray vertices, the main portion of the graph, and the yellow vertices. And what happens is really the optimal phase, since the optimal phase configuration corresponds to max cut, well, this shows in the magnetization of the yellow vertices. So it is some constant times the value of the max cut. But it turns out that figuring out the magnetization of gray vertices is very challenging. And in particular, if you want to understand that, you need to condition on the yellow vertices. And understanding this effect on magnetization from conditioning on the terminals on the yellow vertices of the gadget tends to be a very, very challenging problem, and we don't know the answer. And that's the purpose of our new reduction idea that simplifies the work that needs to be done. So what are the field gadgets? Well, they are cubic trees, right? And the degree of the root is equal to one. And what we'll be interested in is the occupancy ratio of the tree, of the root, as well as its magnetization gap that captures this conditioning effect. So you condition on the root being in the independent set in sigma, and you look at the magnetization, and you take the difference between these two quantities. Right, and that captures the effect of conditioning. So how to use that? Okay, let me show how to modify the previous reduction. Well, the idea is to attach to each edge connecting neighboring gadgets, attach this field gadget. So the final graph looks like something like that. In reality, we have to attach two copies of the trees here and here to maintain the anti-ferromagnetic interaction, but that will not be important. Okay, so what have we done? Now we have gray, yellow, and purple contribution, right? Again, linearity of expectation. And now max cut shows up in the magnetization on the purple part. And what you can show is that you get the magnetization gap shows up in the purple part of the magnetization. Okay, so that looks good, but we still haven't resolved the how to compute the magnetization of gray and yellow vertices. And it seems that we are faced with the same problem. But here the key is now you can change the tree, right? And if you manage to change it so that this part is equal under the two different trees, but this part still maintains some information for max cut, that would be great, right? And that's exactly what we do. So we construct trees T1, T2, so that their occupancy ratio is the same, but the magnetization gap is different. And then what you obtain is that the difference of the magnetization of these final graphs that you construct, well, if you take the difference, well, the idea is that because they have the same occupancy ratio, the distribution on the gray and yellow vertices remain the same. But still, the magnetization gap still persists, this difference of the magnetization gap, right? Because by construction, this are guaranteed to have different magnetization gaps. So you still get some information from max cut. And that's all you need, basically. So, okay, now the next milestone, once you have this reduction idea, which is the main new component, well, how do you actually construct these trees, pairs of trees, right? So that's what we want to achieve. But supposing that you have that, well, you can show using the previous idea, you can show that for all lambda non-uniqueness, where such a pair of gadgets exists, approximating a MG the magnetization with a constant factor is an NP hard problem. So that gives constant factor approximability. And for lambda equals one, for a hardcore model, well, I can give you a picture proof. So these are the two trees. So this theorem implies that we get constant factor and approximability for average independent sets on graphs from maximum degree greater or equal than six. Okay, but it's, in general, it's impossible to perfectly match occupancy ratios for a lambda because, well, the set of such a lambda is countable. These occupancy ratios are rational functions of lambda. So the number of trees is countable. So the set of such lambda where you can hope to construct such gadgets is countable. So the next thing is to construct to achieve that equality approximately. And that's exactly what we do. So we saw an algorithm that takes an input epsilon and gives you two trees, logarithmic in size in terms of epsilon, whose difference in occupancy ratios is at most epsilon, but the magnetization gap is at least some constant C. And the fact that we are able to control the size of these trees so accurately gives the inapproximability factor of 1 plus minus theta 1 over log n by adapting the previous ideas, basically, that I discussed earlier. Okay, so as a corollary of this construction, actually, again, if you view them as rational functions of lambda, then you have that their values are pretty close, but their first derivatives are greater or equal than some absolute constant. And then you can show that the second derivative is nicely uniformly bounded on these trees that we construct. So actually you can match the occupancy ratios for a dense set of lambda, So you get a, and these numbers are actually algebraic because these are rational functions. Okay, so so how do you prove the main technical result? Well, what you can do is look at pairs of trees and try to combine them. So you merge the roots and append an extra vertex, and you can view what happens with the occupancy ratio and magnetization gap, right? So that's the formulas. You don't need to parse them. The point is here that occupancy ratios have actually been well studied for hardcore. And what you can show is that if you look at the fixed point of the three equations for occupancy on the three regular tree, well, you can construct trees with whose occupancy ratios are arbitrarily close to P star, and then you can bootstrap that. For any x close to P star, you can actually construct a tree with occupancy ratio arbitrarily close to x in log one over epsilon time. So this is done for hardcore. It can be adapted relatively straightforward for general two spin systems. The trouble is how to control the magnetization, right? This effect of conditioning. And what we prove is basically what we actually do is to consider these sequences of trees whose occupancy ratio converts to some value x of our choice. And there are two cases to consider. The first case is that there is some sequence that converges to X, but the magnetization gaps do not converge. And then we're done, right? Now the other case is that for all X close to P star, for any sequence of trees converges to X, right? For some magical reason, all the magnetization converges to the same value F of X. And okay, what we do then, we understand this function F of X. We saw that it's continuous and satisfies consistent functional equation. And that leads us to contradiction, so that it cannot happen. So basically case two cannot happen. So case one happens and then we have the required magnetizations. And there are various other details of how to make the argument effect, how to detect non-convergence in log one over epsilon time and so on. But it can be done along the lines of studying the convergence properties of these sequences. Okay, so just to recap, I will stop here. I presented a new technique for proving hardness of approximating averages. And this yields strong inapproximability results for approximating the magnetization and settles the complexity of computing the average independent size on graph C of maximum degree at least 6. Thank you for your attention. Bye.